Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Tudors, A Very Short Introduction by John Guy, narrated by Mary Sarah. Note on Units of Currency. In citing units of currency, the old sterling denominations of pounds, shillings, and pence have been retained. There are 12 pence, 12d, in a shilling. Modern 5 pence or US 8 cents. 20 shillings, 20s, in a pound. 1 pound or US $1.60, and so on. A mark is 13 shillings, 4 pence. 66 pence or US $1.05. Rough estimates of modern values for 16th century figures can be obtained by multiplying all the numbers by 1,000. Chapter 1. Henry VII, founding a new dynasty. Winning the throne. On the morning of May, 22 August, 1485, Henry, Earl of Richmond's, a tall, slender 28-year-old, with blue eyes and thick brown hair, a man with a will of steel and a terrifying urge to power, won the throne of England in a fierce battle fought not far from Market Bosworth in Leicestershire. After initial exchanges of gunfire and arrows, the crack troops of Henry's vanguard attacked the larger forces of the 32-year-old King Richard III on their right wing, and with the sun behind them. A counterattack was repulsed, and as the battle began to turn against him, Richard gambled on a victory by charging forward in a bold attempt to kill Henry, who stood with a small retinue towards the rear of his army. In full armour and wearing his gold battle crown and surcoat of the royal arms, Richard galloped around the site of the main battle at the head of his heavily armed household knights to encircle his rival. Stopped in his tracks by a solid wall of Swiss-trained pikemen who dropped back in a tight formation from Henry's vanguard at the last moment, Richard dismounted and began to fight hand to hand. At this point, Sir William Stanley, Henry's step-uncle, who thus far had been shadowing the rival armies without committing himself, threw his forces into the battle on Henry's side. Cut off from reinforcements, Richard clawed his way through the wall of pikemen and engaged Henry's bodyguards in mortal combat. He reached his rival's standard bearer and cut him down, but was overpowered and bludgeoned to death, after which his battle crown was hacked from his helmet and placed on Henry's head. Henry marched into Leicester and then slowly on towards London, which he entered in triumph on 3 September. Richard's naked corpse was slung on the back of a horse and paraded before the crowds in Leicester, then hastily buried at the Franciscan friary called the Grey Friars. Henry had made his own luck, for when he was born, his father, Edmund, Earl of Richmond, King Henry VI's half-brother, was already dead. His claim to the throne came largely through his redoubtable mother, Lady Margaret Beaufort, the only daughter of John Beaufort, Duke of Somerset, and a great-great-granddaughter of King Edward III, through the liaison of John of Gaunt, Duke of Lancaster, with his long-standing mistress, Catherine Swinford. But in 1407, King Henry IV, the first Lancastrian king, had specifically barred the Beaufort line from the succession, so the young Earl of Richmond's claim was weak. Henry's victory at Bosworth was the culmination of some 30 or so years of dynastic strife and civil wars that had followed Henry VI's mental breakdown in 1453. An attempt by Richard, Duke of York, to capture the throne in 1460 had failed, and York was slain 6 months later at the Battle of Wakefield. But his son Edward succeeded where his father failed, winning the Battle of Towton in 1461. At the age of 18, Edward deposed Henry VI and took the throne as King Edward IV, holding his position more or less unchallenged until 1483. Apart from in 1470 to 71, when Henry VI was briefly restored. When Edward died in April 1483, he was succeeded by the elder of his surviving sons, the 12-year-old Edward V. But in June, the boy was deposed by his uncle, Richard, Duke of Gloucester, who was crowned as Richard III. Gloucester's usurpation reignited the civil wars, also provoking what was strongly rumoured to be the murders in the Tower of London of Edward V and his younger brother Richard. The boys disappeared suddenly, even if the mystery of how exactly they died, who killed them, and how their bodies were disposed of, has never been completely solved. As opinion turned against Gloucester, an underground network of those who feared or hated him offered their support to the young Henry, Earl of Richmond, an exile in Brittany in France since 1471. Margaret Beaufort was among those plotting against Richard, conspiring with Elizabeth Woodville, Edward IV's widow, to agree that if Henry secured the throne, he would quickly marry Woodville's daughter, Elizabeth of York, who was the chief hope of the surviving Yorkists. And the promise was honoured, for less than 6 weeks after Henry was crowned and his title to the throne confirmed by Act of Parliament, he asked Elizabeth to marry him, and the nuptials took place in January 1486. The problem of security. At first, Henry was a highly effective ruler who restored a stable monarchy and took several of Edward IV's trusted counsellors into his service, although he rarely allowed them to take precedence over his fellow exiles or his mother's key advisers, who dominated his inner circle. Elizabeth of York proved herself to be a talented peacemaker, even if she tended to be overshadowed by her overbearing mother-in-law, who styled herself Margaret R., as if she and not Elizabeth were queen. For many former Yorkists, however, the new king was a usurper with the weakest of dynastic credentials. Sullen compliance from such men did not mean acceptance, and the problem of security would trouble Henry for much of his reign. Some of his fears were justified, but others were not, being a result of the darker side of his character, for he was deeply suspicious of all those around him, and, despite his love of tennis, gambling, archery, and above all hunting and hawking, he could be distant and reclusive, often withdrawing into his privy chamber with a few close intimates, and slipping in and out of his palaces by the back door. Had Henry been more trusting, it is possible he would not have been troubled by plots and rebellions for as long as he was. But he faced a dilemma, as a contemporary remarked.
Hard is it to know men's minds, if God should send a sudden change as he hath heretofore.
No one could be sure which way the nobles or leading courtiers would jump in a fresh crisis. On the face of it, Henry was lucky in that, unlike Edward IV, who had begun his reign with his predecessor, not just alive but still at large, his rival, Richard III, was dead, as were so many of the old Yorkist nobles and knights, and there was no obvious cadet, i.e. descended from a younger son, branch of the royal family. Henry was especially fortunate that Elizabeth of York was fecund. She conceived with relative ease, and four of her children, Arthur, born 1486, Margaret, born 1489, Henry, born 1491, and Mary, born 1496, survived into their teenage years or beyond, even if others died young or in infancy. Whether the Queen's fecundity alone could ensure the new dynasty's survival was far from clear. But as an immediate precaution, Henry put the Yorkist with the strongest claim to the throne, Edward, Earl of Warwick, the eldest and only living son of Edward IV's brother, George, Duke of Clarence, in the Tower. Of the leading conspirators and pretenders who dogged Henry in the first 12 years of his reign, Lambert Simnel
was the easiest to deal with. Even though he, or rather his powerful backers, posed a serious threat thanks to widespread support in Ireland and Yorkshire. Described as a comely youth, Simnel was something of a chameleon, first posing as Richard, Duke of York, which was plausible as their ages were the same, and then the Earl of Warwick. His backers included John de la Pole, Earl of Lincoln, a nephew of Edward IV, who had fought for Richard III at Bosworth, and Margaret of York, the Dowager Duchess of Burgundy, Edward's youngest sister and the only one to make a foreign marriage. The young impostor's forces included 2,000 German mercenaries supplied by Margaret and 4,000 Irish foot soldiers. But Henry routed them at the Battle of Stoke, 16 June 1487. Those of Simnel's supporters who were not killed fighting, like the Earl of Lincoln, either fled into exile or were pardoned. Simnel himself was captured and taken into the king's household as a servant, where he worked in the scullery before rising to become a falconer. Fresh plots and revolts in Yorkshire in 1489 and 1491 led to a series of executions, the imposition of large fines, or the flight of the conspirators into exile. Henry had few friends north of the River Trent, the region from which Richard III had drawn most of his support, and many lords and gentry there were, still keen to harness local grievances to Yorkist ends. Until 1500 or so, Henry had only fitful control of the north, where a regional rising, supported by an invasion from Scotland, seemed all too plausible. Increasingly dangerous was a conspiracy nurtured in Ireland in the later months of 1491 that put forth a second pretender, the teenager, Perkin Warbeck, a youth considered to have a striking physical resemblance to Richard, Duke of York. Warbeck was brought up in Tournai, where he had modelled silks for Flemish cloth merchants, trading mainly in Portugal and Ireland, before his backers moved him to the safety of the court of King Charles VIII of France in March 1492. The news of his arrival there obliged Henry to begin preparations for a full-scale war against France. A vast English army crossed the Channel, but Henry proved how his natural guile and skillful diplomacy could often achieve peace and neutralise the Yorkist cause's foreign allies without any actual fighting. After making a show of strength for a month and reasserting Henry V's claim to the French crown, his aim was to make a quick treaty, a move in which Charles VIII connived. Eager to cross the Alps and invade Italy, the French king agreed to drop his support of Warbeck and other Yorkist claimants and to indemnify Henry's costs in full. Warbeck escaped to Malines, in the Burgundian Netherlands, where Margaret of York welcomed him as her long-lost nephew. 5 anxious years followed in which Henry had to deal with plots and revolts, real and imagined, in Ireland especially, in northern England. And on the continent he was boxed into unceasing negotiations and a costly trade war affecting wool and cloth exports to the Netherlands, while Warbeck travelled around collecting fresh backers. By 1495, Warbeck had even sensationally won over the same Sir William Stanley, now the King's Chamberlain of the Household, who had so decisively intervened on Henry's side at the Battle of Bosworth. When Sir William's treasonable correspondence with Warbeck was exposed and he was beheaded, shockwaves ran through Henry's court, since it was plain that Yorkist conspiracy had penetrated deep into the King's inner circle. A crisis was set in train when Warbeck, having botched an invasion of England in the summer of 1495, arrived in Scotland, where King James IV welcomed him and married him in January 1496 to Lady Catherine Gordon, daughter of George, Earl of Huntly. James gave Warbeck and his 1400 followers Falkland Palace as a home, from where the pretender began to plan an invasion of England. The following September, James and Warbeck crossed the frontier, hoping to raise the whole of the North in rebellion. But the raid misfired, and James, to whom Warwick had promised the border town of Berwick, was left to demolish a few towers and burn down crops and houses. Henry, however, believed that this was merely the prelude to a test of his kingship, and set about mustering another battle army, this time to invade Scotland. It was Henry's taxation for the imminent war that triggered a mass revolt in Cornwall. The inhabitants, who had a strong sense of regional identity, and many of whom, in the area west of Truro, still spoke Cornish, refused to pay a tax for a campaign in Scotland, which they believed a land tax levied in the northern shires alone was the correct source of finance. Led by a blacksmith from St. Kevin on the Lizard, and by the son of one of the king's own tax commissioners, a large army of rebels set off in May 1497 to march to London. In Somerset, they were joined by a disaffected noble, Lord Audley, and by the time they camped on Blackheath near Greenwich, they were more than 15,000 strong. No sooner had Henry's forces defeated the rebels and hanged or beheaded the ringleaders than the king turned to Scotland. Once again, luck was on his side. In August that year, he was able to make a truce with James IV to last for 7 years at Ayton in Cleveland. By the terms of the accord, James abandoned his claim to Berwick and agreed to revoke the safe conduct he had granted to Henry's rebels since 1495. More to the point, he expelled them from his realm and agreed to terms binding each of the two rulers not to harbour each other's rebels. Furthermore, it was agreed that when the truce expired, James would marry Henry's eldest daughter, Margaret, thereby cementing the truce into what at the time was called a treaty of perpetual peace. Barely had Henry time to breathe before Warwick's forces landed in Cornwall in September 1497, and a fresh revolt began. When he disembarked, Warwick had barely 300 supporters, but by the time they laid siege to Exeter, they had been joined by the remnants of the rebel forces from Blackheath, and were said to be 8,000 strong. Troops led by the Earl of Devon withstood the siege, and the invaders withdrew to Taunton, as Henry's forces, many of them mustered to fight in Scotland, marched at full speed towards them. The rebels began to melt away. Warwick fled, but was soon captured and paraded through the streets of London as an impostor. Locked up by Henry, he escaped, but was recaptured. He was finally hanged in November 1499, after he and two accomplices plotted to free both himself and the real Earl of Warwick from their cells in the Tower and to place one of them on the throne. At this point, Warwick's escape plot was made the pretext for beheading the Earl, who was put on trial for conspiring to depose Henry. There was, however, a more pressing reason why Warwick had to die. In 1488, Henry, who was keen to secure a dynastic alliance with one of the strongest powers in Europe, had begun negotiations with King Ferdinand of Aragon and his wife Isabella of Castile, designed to betroth their youngest daughter, Catherine, to Prince Arthur. By the Treaty of Medina del Campo, 1489, Ferdinand and Isabella had closed Spain to Yorkist pretenders, and a future marriage alliance was settled in principle. The young couple were then married by proxy, though this was not considered to be binding, in May 1499, when a final agreement was reached on a substantial dowry. Ferdinand and Isabella agreed that Catherine would be sent to England when Arthur was 14. However, the Spanish monarchs, besides haggling over the enormous dowry demanded by Henry, were anxious about the threat to Henry's regime from Yorkist plots, and the diplomatic evidence suggests that it was their concerns that led to Warwick's trial and execution. Even before Warwick was beheaded, Edmund de la Pole, Earl of Suffolk, a younger brother of the rebel Earl of Lincoln, and the next in line as a convincing Yorkist claimant, came to fear for his life. Being loyal to Henry,
Suffolk had ignored Lord Bergavenny's suggestion that they both join Lord Audley in the Cornish rebels, and he had removed Bergavenny's shoes at a crucial moment so as to immobilize him. But as a punishment for Lincoln's treachery, Henry placed draconian conditions on Suffolk's rights of inheritance. And in July 1499, the Earl travelled without license, first to Guin, one of the flanking fortresses of the last English outpost in France at Calais, and then to Saint-Omer in Flanders, seeking the protection of his aunt, Margaret of York. His friends, among them Sir James Tyrrell, a member of Henry's garrison at Calais, entertained him and secretly offered him help should he wish to defect permanently. Suffolk was persuaded to return and heavily fined, but 2 years later he fled for good with his brother Richard to Aachen, where he began to plot a Yorkist invasion of England. Henry struck back, mobilizing a web of spies and informers to infiltrate Suffolk's retinue. He rounded up and imprisoned at the Tower or the castle at Calais most of the surviving males with a Yorkist connection. In a purge lasting 4 years between 1502 and 1506, the Earl's supporters were interrogated. Sir James Tyrrell was beheaded, and Suffolk and his retinue were declared by the courts to be outlaws with a bounty on their heads. Meanwhile, Catherine of Aragon had arrived in England, and she and Arthur were married at Old St. Paul's Cathedral on 14 November 1501. Arthur, at the age of 3, had been invested as Prince of Wales in a splendid ceremony in the Parliament chamber at Westminster, was now 15. It was decided that he and Catherine, who was almost a year older, should travel to his princely capital of Ludlow on the borders of Wales and live there together in the royal apartments at the castle as man and wife. This was at the zenith of Henry's reign, the point at which, for the first time since he had captured the crown, he had almost everything within his control. With Arthur and Catherine married and living together, a grandson for Henry might now also be expected. With the exception of the problem of Edmund and Richard de la Pole, who paradoxically rose higher on the king's radar, even as he marginalized and impoverished them by his intensively active diplomacy, it looked as if the Tudor dynasty had a secure future. Creating a new monarchy. A hands-on ruler for whom no detail was too small, Henry checked the most important accounts of his receipts and expenditure personally, often signing them on every page. Dedicated and attentive, astute and aesthetic, his view of the need for a more interventionist and centralized government was modelled less on traditional English values and more on those of Brittany and France, where he had been in exile. His mantra was enforcement. The enforcement of political and financial obligation to the king, as much as of law and order after the civil wars. In restoring the power of the monarchy, he held that ability, good service, and loyalty to the regime, rather than noble birth, were to be the essential qualifications for appointments, patronage, and rewards. Whereas the Yorkist kings had been content to partner the nobility in government, Henry's goal was a monarchy in which the nobles served the king. Only veteran Lancastrian peers, such as John de Vere, Earl of Oxford, could count themselves safe. To subordinate the nobles, Henry subverted their territorial influence, heavily fining them simply for taking up their inheritances when they succeeded to their estates, closely vetting which of them should continue to be appointed as local magistrates, and undercutting their authority wherever he could by taking their leading gentry supporters into his own household. Henry's key advisors at the time he won the throne were men who had either been with him in exile or were introduced to him by his mother, notably Cardinal John Morton, Richard Fox, Giles Daubeny, and Sir Reynold Bray. Others, like John, Lord Dinham, had been loyal servants of Edward IV, who had switched their allegiance. Of those Henry appointed in the months and years after his coronation, he preferred ambitious middling gentry and sharp-eyed lawyers such as Sir Thomas Lovell, Sir Henry Wyatt, and later, and most notoriously, Richard Epsom and Edmund Dudley. Progressively, he turned them into a distinctive cadre of new men, whom Perkin Warbeck, attempting to win noble support, disparaged as caitiffs and villains, i.e., base wretches and scoundrels of simple birth, whom the king alone trusted. Bray, for instance, was a former estate officer for Margaret Beaufort and a surgeon's son. Ably supported by Lovell as treasurer of the king's chamber, and Wyatt as master of the king's jewels, whose fathers were minor gentry, he established himself as Henry's chief financial controller and enforcer of his rights, using a much-feared tribunal known as the Council Learned in Law. When Bray died in 1503, Epson, said to be a sieve-maker's son and a brilliant lawyer, succeeded him, partnered by Dudley, another scion of a lesser gentry family and a star of the legal profession who rose to be Speaker of the House of Commons. Such men exercised control under the king, far in excess of their apparent status, for in a surprisingly short space of time, Henry managed to devise a novel mesh of interlocking fiscal and administrative checks and blueprints, the records of which never left his own hands or those of the chosen few. These dealt with financial accounting, the exploitation of the undervalued resources of the crown lands, the collection of debts and fines, and the enforcement of Henry's punitive system of forcing political opponents, or even apparent friends, to enter into coercive bonds for future conduct, such as allegiance, appearance before a court of law, or goods abarring, i.e. behaviour. In overseeing these myriad functions, Henry's new men proved themselves to be dedicated agents of royal power. Meritocratic, focused, efficient, and as potentially unscrupulous and as quick to pick up on treason as the king himself. A series of calamities. Just when it seemed in the closing months of 1501 that the new dynasty was secured, a series of sudden blows stunned Henry. His troubles began in early February 1502, when Prince Arthur, his heir in the dynasty's hope, fell sick at Ludlow Castle. After 27 March, his condition rapidly worsened until, on 2 April, he died from an unknown cause, which from the inadequately recorded symptoms may have been plague, tuberculosis, or testicular cancer. Attempting to comfort him, Elizabeth of York reminded Henry that they had a healthy second son and two daughters and could try for another child. Sure enough, Elizabeth was soon pregnant again. On 2 February 1503, she was successfully delivered of a daughter, but she never recovered from her labor and died in the morning of a 37.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.